Hello everyone, and welcome back to my efficient design series in Kerbal Space Program 0.24.2. In this episode, we'll start off by looking at what I can do with the science I've accumulated, especially from Minmus. I'm hoping to reach for either Duna or land a Kerbal on the moon and return that Kerbal. Those are the two goals. We've already landed a Kerbal on Minmus and brought him back, so we don't need to worry about that. But the key is to keep it reusable. So if we try for Duna, we have to make sure we can bring our Duna Explorer back. Now, we could do the Duna mission in a number of ways. We could send an unmanned probe to Duna to just get that information without landing it. We could try a lander on Duna, unmanned again. We could have a manned flyby of Duna, hopefully also getting Icon that way. But of course, the most difficult one would be landing a Kerbal on Duna, but I wouldn't want to try that reusable without at least practicing the reusable system on a flyby first. So that's probably the idea. I think we will need better engines if we want to make this completely... with the engines we've got, we can do a Duna mission, that's fine. But if we really wanted to make it reusable, that's the trick. So let's get heavy rocketry here. Fuel lines will be helpful for our staging. We might as well have launch stability enhancers, because the bigger our rocket is, the more likely we're going to use that. The radial decouplers seem to be superfluous when you're not going to be knocking stuff off. So, okay. Probably need the 2.5 meter stuff if we're going to start using the skipper. So, okay. And these are aircraft parts, which I really need to do in this series because, of course, aircraft are reusable by nature. So I will look into that, but let's focus on some science, perhaps, because we're running out of actual points here. So we need to find some scientific stuff. Ooh, these small ones. Ah, there's so much stuff that we could unlock. These little guys could be really helpful. But not for a reusable system, huh? Well, we could separate it and return it separately. Yeah, I guess we could. Well, that's the thing. We could launch the launcher and get it into orbit around Kerbin. And then we could have the Duna transit stage not fully burn for Duna. Well, in fact, the launcher can just do part of the burn for Duna, as long as it stays within the Kerbin sphere of influence. It could return to Kerbin then, and then the Duna portion would continue on and might use some of these small engines. I think, though, my electric charge situation is perhaps a little bit more important on such a long mission. Yeah, let's go for solar panels. That's always a thing. All right, now we don't have any science to unlock the rest, so let's see what we can do with the parts we've got now. And here we are. So I've done the building off camera, and that's because it took a little bit of calculation work. And what you see here is a Duna flyby craft, hopefully capable of doing some science around Ike as well. I have kept it pretty spare. We'll get a Kerbal around there to do EVA stuff, and then next time we'll use the same vehicle to get some other science. So instead of having a pod on top, we'll replace it with the science junior and the goo experiments. So we'll do it that way, and hopefully by then we'll unlock some barometer or something like that, so we'll be able to get more science that way. But basically, it's the same configuration as usual. In other words, this is the portion that will get everything into orbit and then return. You'll notice it has a probe core right here, so we don't need to have an extra Kerbal in, so that's good. And of course, this is the portion that will actually get to Duna, do the science there, and then come back. So, reusable. These solid rocket boosters do not come off, and it basically, I was down about 100 to, I was short the amount that it takes to retro burn from this stage, so that's why I put the solid rocket boosters on. I figure that'll be good enough, but I'm not sure. We'll see. I might be wrong about that. So basically, this center bit has about 4,400 meters per second, between that and 4,500, just enough to get into orbit, but definitely not enough to retro burn. So I had that problem. So the solid boosters will fire. The center engine will not actually fire on launch. These guys will get it to high altitude, well, a reasonable altitude first. And the benefit of that is that we get to an altitude where the ISP of the skipper engine is closer to its maximum. And so we'll get some benefit from that in terms of efficiency. Part of the problem was the mass of the parachutes. So I've got that issue. I have remembered to put batteries all over the place, some solar panels. I haven't put any extendable solar panels this time. Maybe I should put two just in case, but I don't think we'll, strictly speaking, need them. They're very light though. Okay, so this is our Duna mission, our first Duna mission. Let's go to the tracking station to make sure that we're in alignment with Duna for the transfer. Okay, so here we are, and let's just catch up with Duna. We need to be at a 45 degree angle. I'm just estimating by sight. Okay, that looks like it's even tighter than 45 degrees. Okay, we'll go for that. Alright, so let's just take it out to the launch pad. Oop, don't forget to pick up some contracts. In fact, we've got an Explore Duna contract here. We should be able to do these first two on this one, and we'll get a nice advance. So okay, Explore Ike, we'll try that out too. I don't think we'll get orbit around Ike, but we'll be able to recover some scientific data from it. Looks like we've got some moon stuff, so I'm going to pick those up right now. I'll have to do a rescue one sometime, but let's get some of this basic stuff done first, as far as I'm concerned, basic anyway. So, we'll go for the moon next episode. Let's just focus on Duna this time. Okay, and our Duna Explorer will be Jorvi Kerbin. Here's Jorvi Kerbin. SAS is on, throttle is up, though not functional. It looks like our landing struts are holding this thing properly. I hope there's some ground clearance there. I can't see. I've locked the suspension on the struts. I can't really see if there's any ground clearance there. Let's hope so. Okay. Maybe you shouldn't lock suspension on the struts. Alright. Anyway, we'll find out. Okay, let's go, Jovi. Okay, gear up. Yes, no? Okay, good. It was a dodgy question whether I could have the strut situation be as it is, because I've basically tripled up the couplers here in order to stretch the landing struts down. Okay, I'm gonna light the main engine now. No point having a discontinuous burn here. Oh, we're losing thrust. That's weird. I thought I had this calculated right, but I guess I don't. What's the ISP on this now? That's a little bit short. Okay, that's funny. I wonder where I must have missed calculating some mass somewhere. I calculated 0.5 for each of these. I think that's right. Anyway, we're positive now. But I'll have to fix that. Maybe use the bigger boosters, but then they'll just be heavier, so I'll have to work out the math on that. Probably not, otherwise this will be even worse. So it depends. Well, no, if it burns earlier, if I light it earlier, it'll have burned some of the fuel from here. Yeah, maybe I should just light it on the launch pad. then it'll burn some of the fuel from the tanks, and yeah, I'll lose the ISP, but at least we won't start losing vertical velocity. Okay, so that's a plan. You know what I should do? I should just have, I mean, it's more expensive, of course, but I should just have, like, the LV-909s or even the T-45s on some small fuel tanks off to the side. Maybe not even small fuel tanks, larger ones. It'll be more expensive, though. This whole mission costs about 50k, so that's pretty good for a Duna mission, I think. But I might have to do better than that. Jorvi looks happy. Well, Jorvi knows that he's going to be fine, even if this launch vehicle can't get back down, so probably shouldn't be paying attention to what he thinks. Well, no point using even a little bit more than I need to. Okay, Okay, so what we're going to do is we're going to detach the Duna mission, have it get into orbit maybe, and then bring this back down. Or we could get it close to orbit. Yeah. We'll see. Let's get closer to our apoapsis here. How much fuel do we have in the tanks? I don't think the solid rocket booster idea was a good idea. Okay, 135. Alright. Okay, that's the end of that stage. So it's coming back down, just not where we want it to be. Fair enough. Oh, totally in the dark now. Still didn't want to use lights just yet. Okay, so we're going to decouple. Still reusable, it's still coming back down. But we need to worry about our main mission here first. Alright. I do not have too much margin on this, by the way. So anything that we have to do here hinders our ability to do more once we get to Duna. So for instance, the Ike, anything to do with Ike might be a problem now. Okay, that's in orbit. Okay, good thing we don't have a Kerbal in here. Electric charge looks to be okay. So this thing is descending back down. And there's the atmosphere. Don't know how much value we're gonna get from this. Probably not much. We've got a reaction wheel on here, so I can turn to retrograde without firing anything. That's important. But probably might have to consider dumping that reaction wheel just to save mass. We'll see. Okay. The tanks are pretty heavy after all. That's the thing. But I think I misjudged how much I would get out of the solid boosters instead of just rockets there. Liquid fuel rockets. Okay, so let's just get this down quickly. There is no Kerbal in danger drama here. Okay. And with that, can't really see where we are or what kind of terrain we're over. Put gear down. SAS off. Parachutes out. Parachutes out. Very good. Ooh. Extra sounds going on here. If we could lose some of the parachutes, that'd be helpful. I mean, if we could do without them, because they weigh quite a lot. The 12 parachutes that we have here combined weigh about 1.2 tons. No, is that right? No, 1.8 tons, sorry. 1.8 tons, which is quite a lot. Well, everything depends on whether the skipper engine survives. Again, the cost of stuff doesn't quite match what reality would have, but I still am most concerned with the engines, even though the pricing of the vehicles doesn't really favor the engines as much. Okay, parachutes are open. 6.3. Yeah, I think we could do without some parachutes. Oh no. Oh. Oh, quickly, quickly. No, no. Oh. Okay. Somewhat uneven land. And of course, the fact that the struts didn't have suspension. Well, the fact that they didn't have suspension probably saved the skipper, maybe. I'm not sure. But let's see what we lost. Rechargeable battery pack and the radial mount parachute. Okay. I'll recover vessel now. Okay, nothing in particular. I wonder where we got the 95 science from. I mean, in other words, I had less than 90 science before, right? So how do we get 5 points of science? Did we accidentally do a... I don't even know. I don't know if it would show it right now anyway. I'm wondering if I accidentally did a contract of some kind. Anyway, we only got 38% of the value of that launcher back. But something is better than nothing, so let's focus on our main mission now. Certainly the thing now is to make sure Jorvi comes back, and to do that, we are going to... What sort of terrain is over here? Doesn't that seem like it's sort of badly folded somehow? Huh. Anyway, to do that we're gonna need to airbrake around Duna. So that's a mission requirement for this one. I've left some slack in the whole mission planning, but really we do need to airbrake. So that's gonna be interesting. Easy enough to boost out to Duna. In fact, without looking, I'd say about there. Close. Seems like our timing was a little bit further off than I thought. Not too critical in the case of Duna, but would be pretty bad in the case of some other missions, so gotta be a little bit more accurate about these things. Okay, I think I'm gonna have to take about 5,000 kilometers from out here. That'll be fine. There's no inclination to worry about as such. We're gonna be hitting Duna right around the descending node, so we'll be lined up with it. Oop. Okay, so here we are. Seems like we're pretty much lined up with our maneuver node. 14 more minutes. Our charge is stable. Okay, probably will take us some time to do this burn. So, this is about where I want to start. Let's see. Yeah, about right. This estimated burn time isn't always correct. We should put lights next time. I think we've got the solar panels now. I think we can be a little bit more free about that. Let's try and do this. Oh, nope, going the wrong way here. Looks like we can only get 17 or so thousand kilometers. Okay. Alright, we'll have to call that good enough. Let's say we do a mid-course plane change. Well, not really a plane change since the ascending node is right there. But perhaps an adjustment of some sort. I think we might have to do it at the descending node here instead. Descending node means we go up. Okay, there we go. I think with that we'd be crashing into Duna. Which is always good, you know. Okay, there we go. 13 kilometers. Should be about right for what we want to do. 26 meters per second. Not bad. I wonder if anybody's figured out whether a Kerbin Duna cycler is possible. A cycler is a craft that can go back and forth between Duna and Kerbin, encountering them at regular intervals. So you usually have to have it so that it goes beyond Duna's orbit and comes back like that. And to calculate it out, it has to have something to do with the relationship between the orbits, but I wonder if anybody's done that yet. It's possible to make a Earth-Mars cycler, and that was advocated by Buzz Aldrin among other people. So that's a thing that can be done. And if the relationship between Earth's orbit and Duna's orbit is Kerbin's orbit and Duna's orbit is the same as Earth and Mars, then it should be possible to do it for this system as well. I don't know if anybody's done it yet or not, though. Okay, so 61 days. Jovi looks copacetic. I think we're good to go. We've used less than half of our fuel so far, which is good because the burn we've already done is the longest burn that is involved. As long as we can aerobrake around Duna, we should be alright. The return journey is much, much less taxing. By the way, I was looking into doing a Voyager-like mission and possibly a subsequent Cassini-like mission in real solar system. And what I discovered was if you time warp real solar system for an extended period of time, like 20 years or so, it has a lot of asteroids, and the real solar system adds asteroids in other locations. It's actually got the asteroid belt, and it's got the Kuiper belt on the outside. So that's pretty neat. However, I ended up with about 32,000 asteroids, and it basically crashed the tracking station screen whenever I tried to go to that. So I had to manually eliminate asteroids from the persistent file in order to make that work out. So just a fair warning for those of you who are using real solar system, you can get a pretty substantial asteroid belt, but you might want to keep track of how many asteroids you're actually generating in that, because it can get out of hand not quickly. We're talking about time warping 20 years or so, but it can get out of hand eventually. Oh, and they also had the Trojan asteroids, the ones that share orbit with Jupiter. Okay, looks like we've actually got a 25-kilometer minimum or something like that. So, but that's great from this position. Okay, so, yep, let's continue. We have to get into the Duna system, and then I can check out what my aerobraking altitude should be, make a final adjustment for that. And it should be around 11 kilometers or something like that. Okay, so I've already done aerobraking calculator, and I've set the target apoapsis to be Ike's orbit. I mean, why not, right? So, it says 13,280 meters, which is not far off from my estimate of 11,000. 11,000 would have been for a tighter orbit around Duna. So, I think I had it right for a tight orbit. Just if you're going to go for an Ike orbit, then that's different. So we're not far off now. We've already gotten down to 34. So we just need a little bit more. Very little bit more, actually. Might even be a little bit hard to do such a fine adjustment from out here. I'll keep it to 16,000 for now, and then we'll adjust it further as we get closer in. Okay, quick burst, please. Well, that's probably as much as I can do. Alright, fine. If I try and light it again, I'm not going to be able to get any closer. Let's say we add a maneuver over here, and is there a possibility we can do a... Wow. Getting 13,280 is going to be a little bit tough. No, we'll have to be even closer than that. It doesn't like me sliding maneuver nodes here. Which reminds me, I have to fix the patched conics in the install where I want to do the Voyager mission, otherwise I'm not going to be able to see my intercepts ahead of time. Okay, that's close enough. 0.6, that looks good. Alright, let's watch our approach to Duna. Where is Duna? Should be in line with it, but it might be in the dark. Oh, there it is. There it is. Okay, good. Actually, Jorvi, while we're here, you know what to do? Okay, yeah. Hi. In space over Duna, 56. Keep data. Board. Let's get one of our temperature readings, so it can't be done from out here. Okay. Let's wait our 10-hour wait. Okay, adjustment for the aerobraking. Let's take a look. Whoa! It also responded with a delay to my ignition command, which was a little bit irritating. Okay, I think I'll have to go with that. Until we get closer anyway. So let us do that. Okay, we are now within Ike's orbit. Maybe we can do a more precise burn to get the number I wanted. I'm actually lighting the engine, but it doesn't like me. Hopefully that's not too much. Okay, well, we'll just have to go with that. Alright, orient retrograde. Good deal. We better have gotten this right, Jorvi, otherwise you're going to be... might be stranded on Duna, who knows. Fortunately, you have parachutes and everything. And plenty of fuel. Actually, there's no good reason why you'd be stranded on Duna. Okay, here we go. Atmosphere. Speaking of which, let us check the thermometer reading. No, not toggle. Oh, this must be the one that we've already used. Okay, in space near Duna. Keep that data. And we should get an atmospheric one as well. But that might take a while. Would like a crew report. Okay, planet appears very red, appears to have deep brown furrows across the surface. There does appear to be some kind of ice at both poles though. Keep that. Okay, well there's about as much atmosphere as we're gonna catch on this one. Nope, still in space. Oh well. Not quite getting in orbit just yet. Oh wait, I see the churn getting more and more convincing here. Taking a while though. Oh, there we go. The characteristic camera tilt as you get into orbit. We seem to be a little bit off from Ike's orbit in terms of inclination. And we seem a little bit short from my target too, but that's because I ended up taking a periapsis a little bit lower. Okay. Looking good so far, Jorvi. And we probably need to get you into a stable orbit, but we might as well do the EVA around Duna first. The near to Duna. But we'll get you safely out of the atmosphere for that. A lot of little artifacting on Duna today. Okay, we've got all the time warpings, so should be good to go. Yep, good. Board. Okay, so I think I'm going to temporarily wrap it up here, and what I'll do is in the next episode I'm going to try for some Ike science and then also bring Jorvi back home. So I think that'll be the next episode. If that turns out to be a short time, then I will try and do something with the science that we gain from all of this. Perhaps make the first airplane in this series. So we'll see, but it depends how long it takes for me to get Jorvi over to well, wait a minute, I really should get him in a stable orbit first, right? Okay, let me take care of that quickly. This is hilarious. This is like the first time Ike doesn't try and troll us. Weird. I mean, even as we brought the orbit in, it didn't even look at all like we were ever going to hit Ike, so... strange. Okay, so here we go. Just need to boost our orbit a little bit. That'll do. Okay, so now we're in a stable orbit around Duna. Jovi's within spitting distance of Ike here. But we'll take care of that next time and also bring him back. So, On that note, thank you for watching. If you enjoyed this video, please do press like. If you have any comments or suggestions, please leave them in the comments section below. And I'll see you next time.